This young hopeful is trying to catch the eye of a potential mate. He starts by showing off his paddle-like antennae. His technique may not be very impressive to us, but he is in fact sending the female secret signals.
This is the epaulette shark. The crew wants to film David up close to this slippery character.
There's one with the tail. The first one is there, tail is there.
Just there.
One under there.
Marine biologist Professor Gillian Renshaw has been studying these sharks for 20 years.
It's very hard to see the epaulettes because they're cryptically colored and blend in very well with fingers of coral that are rising out of the reef platform.
It's a tricky location because it's only accessible for a short window of time.
We've got probably about 40 minutes to get all of the shots that we need. Two pieces to camera and lots of nice shots of the epaulette shark. So I shouldn't really be talking to you. We should be getting this.
Okay, quiet please.
Camera's rolling.
And action, David.
The epaulette shark remains on the reef even when the tide goes out. Of course, with so little water, it doesn't get as much oxygen as it requires normally.
Although David's shots finish quickly, the team still needs to film the shark's startling walking behavior.
The water is literally pouring in around the equipment and over our feet. We've got about 10 to 15 minutes to get this sequence finished and get back in the boat before we're literally cut off and we can't get back to the boats.
Time is of the essence, chaps.
The tide floods in around the crew.
He's walking beautifully.
That was a really nice performance from the epaulette shark.
That's another great sequence in the can for the series. Dwarf minke whales are usually dispersed throughout the Southern Oceans. But once a year, they mysteriously gather at the Great Barrier Reef. It's thought they may be checking out potential mates. Dr. Dean Miller, the scientific videographer on the minke research project, has a lot riding on this moment.
The last thing I want is a leak. That will mean the end of the camera and the end of the filming season and the research season. Things are going crazy here at the moment, so I'm going to put it together and get going.
Though normally loners, these whales become strikingly sociable at the reef, seeking out other minkes and even divers.
It's a little bit unnerving sometimes jumping in and seeing a 7-ton, 7-meter animal come out from the gloom. You're hoping that it is going to be the whale and not something with a few more teeth.
At first, the whales keep their distance. But Dean has mastered the minke tricks of the trade.
If you're not looking, they tend to come a lot closer. So if I can see a whale approaching in the distance and I know it's going to be a good approach this time, I'll purposely hold off and turn my dome around and actually see in the reflection of the dome the whale coming to me. And then when I think it's probably about 5 to 6 meters away, I'll turn around and get the best shot I've had all day.
Today, Dean's long hours have paid off.
That was awesome. I just had one of the best passes I've ever had. That was really cool. Less than a meter. Perfect day.
Perfect all round.
This is the crown of thorns starfish. For it, coral is food, and it will eat relentlessly if not kept in check. But to other creatures like the guard crab, coral is home. The crab is prepared to defend its patch from the carnivorous starfish at all costs. The crown of thorns, however, is much larger than most other starfish on the reef, so the tiny crab is forced to take a more stealthy approach. Hidden within the coral, it waits for its moment to attack. When When it can, the crab uses its powerful pincers to snip at the starfish's spines and tube-like feet. Before retreating back into the safety of the coral. The crab has won this battle. The first of the hatchlings start to emerge. But for the young hatchlings, the trials of life have only just begun. Each new arrival will have to make a perilous dash to reach the ocean. Now, they're on their own. Inevitably, the tiny defenseless hatchlings attract scores of predators. Terns and herons patrol the beach. And in the shallows, reef sharks lie in wait. Great numbers are lost, but enough will make it to the ocean to ensure the species' survival. Corals are usually able to adapt to changing circumstances given enough time. And that is partly due to the way they reproduce. After the first full moon in October, the great synchronized coral spawning event begins. Hundreds of species release sperm and eggs into the ocean. Just as pollen from plants is blown far and wide by the wind, so coral spawn is swept away by the ocean currents. And at the same time, under the same moonlight, the corals will spawn here in the laboratory tanks. Using red light so as not to disturb the process, scientists wait for the moment of release. And when it finally happens, they move fast to collect the sperm and the eggs. It's their one chance to get all the samples they need for a year's worth of research. In the ocean, there is the potential for different species of coral to breed with each other. So here scientists wonder if you might be able to produce a new kind of coral that proves more successful in the changing waters of the reef. Scientists' aim is to use selective breeding to produce strains of coral that are able to withstand the worst effects of climate change. And to use them to bring life back to the worst affected part of the reef. These are the beauty salons of the reef, and they're often run by a pair of wrasse, small fish with a stripe running from head to tail. These committed cleaners regularly tend to a host of different creatures. They provide a vital service, removing the dead skin and parasites from outside and even inside their clients' bodies. It may seem like a thankless task, but the cleaner fish are getting a good meal out of it. And of all their clients, the manta rays are their star customers. The manta rays surrender themselves completely. Within seconds, a host of fish rush to their side. Each fish tends to a very specific part of the manta's body. And the cleaning can last a full hour. For the most part, the surface is second to none. But occasionally, the cleaners can get a little carried away. A female wrasse has taken a nibble out of the manta ray's flesh. She's broken the rules, and there's a price to pay. Her partner chases after her. It's the cleaner fish equivalent of a stern telling off. If the bite is a one-off, the manta ray will return. But research has shown that if it happens too often, the pair risks driving regular visitors away. Fortunately, it seems her indiscretion hasn't put their client off. The manta is back and business has resumed. Mantis shrimps have earned themselves a reputation for being somewhat ill-tempered. But scientists have discovered that there's another side to these macho males. This young hopeful is trying to catch the eye of a potential mate. He starts by showing off his paddle-like antennae. His technique may not be very impressive to us, but he is in fact sending the female secret signals. And that is possible, because mantis shrimps can see and reflect a kind of light that absolutely no other creature in the world that we know of can see. The male's display is a private invitation for this female to dance. So far, so good. She makes her way to the dance floor. If the male can impress the female with his performance, she will choose him to father her offspring. It seems that this male has all the right moves. The final phase of courtship, however, usually takes place out of sight, within their burrows. Clownfish deal with the problem of overcrowding by sharing space with another creature, gigantic anemones. They've formed a relationship in which both parties benefit. Anemones have tentacles that are packed with stinging cells. Most fish, touching one, get a very nasty sting. But not the clownfish, thanks to the protective layer of mucus that covers its body. The clownfish keeps the anemone in good health by removing unwanted parasites. And in return, the anemone offers security. Its stinging cells ward off the sort of creatures which would otherwise threaten the clownfish. When the time comes for a pair to breed, that protection will be vital. A female may lay up to 1,000 eggs on the rock beneath her anemone home. As she delicately attaches them, the male follows closely behind, fertilizing the eggs as he goes. A week will pass before the young are ready to emerge. Hatching only happens at night, so to record it, we have to use infrared cameras in a specialized filming environment. This is the very first time that this behavior has been filmed. With gentle encouragement from their father, the young are helped on their way. Once the little larvae are set free, they're on their own. They'll spend the first few weeks of their life developing in the open ocean.